taking off.
We partnered up with the Forest Service to kind of do a proof of concept on some mining lands where there's some leftover tailings, and we're looking at if we can use high-resolution photography to create both two-dimensional and three-dimensional models of this area to determine how much of this material may or may not need to come out of here for reclamation work. We're flying three different sites between two different mines here in this part of Oregon, and then we're going to move over to the Umpqua National Forest tomorrow and fly another mine over in that area. These aircraft are relatively inexpensive, and they can fly very low, so we're flying, you know, below the treetop levels here, collecting that imagery. If we were going to do the same thing via some other avenue, airplane or a helicopter, it's a very risky mission anytime we fly low level with those aircraft. So this is a good opportunity for us to prove the utility of this type of system with really no risk to anybody in the air. We're using a quadcopter, it's the solo aircraft, and then we're using a flight planning system to actually lay out our transects and conduct the flight.
I'd like to call them ground control targets, and basically the ground control has two purposes. One is to tie in the imagery that we're collecting with some real world coordinates. So I put the targets out. The targets are monitored by the cameras. I take a GPS of the targets so that once we collect the imagery, we can identify precisely on the face of the earth where the targets are located.
The payload that we're using is a Ricoh camera. It's an off-the-shelf consumer-grade camera. We set the camera to trigger every second, so as we move along at 10 miles an hour, we're capturing a image every second over the area. We then feed that imagery into a program that will process it, and it takes all the different pixels from all the thousands of images that we collect and figures out how to stitch that together into one big mosaic. And then from there, we can actually create a bunch of different products, including 2D maps of the area and three-dimensional surface models of the area.
Once you stitch those photos together in PhotoScan, we can produce what's called an ortho mosaic, which is just basically a picture like you'd see in Google Maps, a two-dimensional picture that just will show the valley where we flew. You can also create a three-dimensional point cloud, similar to what folks think of as LIDAR, where we actually will be able to see elevation differences between the lower points in the valley here and the berms up on the road. And that's really, for this particular mission, the Forest Service is interested in calculating some volumetric measurements of some of the rock piles that are in here. And so what we'll be able to do is actually create two surfaces. We can create a surface that's sort of along the base of the landscape, and then create a second surface that represents the berm. And sort of you subtract the two, and what you get is the volume that needs of the actual materials that we've imaged.
We're in a relatively confined canyon here. And so what we do is we save some imagery, aerial imagery of this area on the computer and the tablet. We can then go back in and essentially draw a polygon in the tablet of the area of interest that we want to survey. It will then automatically calculate based on the amount of overlap we need on each image. So in order to create a map, we have to have like 60, 70, sometimes 90% overlap of these images. So that flight planning software calculates that, lays out the path. We verify that we're not going to run into anything, trees, and set the speed to the correct speed to gather that imagery. And then essentially we put it in automatic mode, and then we're there to monitor our distance away from where it took off and current altitude of the aircraft above the takeoff. All of the signals to control the aircraft go through what we call the hand controller. And the tablet is linked to the hand controller via Wi-Fi network, and it's also then the hand controller is also linked to the aircraft via Wi-Fi network. And so we can kind of switch back and forth flying, either using the hand controller, manually flying it, or we can use the tablet to execute the flight plans that we put in there.
Are overlaps set correctly?
We're doing a combination. There's certain things that we can just go out and do hand flying to get some images, and then for larger surveys, more kind of consistent triggering of the camera over time, then we'll do the pre-planned flights using the tablet. the weather has been great, so we got lucky there. But, you know, anytime you come to a new site, it's difficult without actually seeing the terrain to know how the vehicle's going to operate. Are you going to have any issues with connectivity? Is there a lot of public in the area? You know, interfacing with people as they're coming up and down the road. So it's great if we can do a site visit prior to missions, but it's not always possible. In terms of mission planning, there's just some specific things about how we configure the software that would make us a little bit more efficient. We've done enough of these types of missions that I have a high level of confidence that we'll be able to produce some product out of this.
Unmanned aerial systems is a relatively new technology. It's been around for a few years and it's evolving very rapidly. And what it's doing is kind of filling an information gap between field work and, you know, manned aircraft systems, satellite systems. So it enables engineers and specialists to go out in the field with not just a GPS or a camera, but with another tool to collect spatial information and better utilize their time spent on that site and increase safety as well. The products exceeded expectations, not just the quality of the imagery and stereo that was collected by the drone using a commercially available camera, but the post-processing done by the Geospatial Technology and Application Center, producing these 3D models, and then even removing some of the vegetation so environmental engineers can get an idea of the terrain and the volume of, say, a tailings pile. And from that information, those outputs, knowing the volume of that tailings pile, engineers have a better idea of the level of effort, the cost, and time it will take to move that waste rock, clean up that site, to a repository. It's really exciting to have worked on these projects and to have worked with Fire and Aviation Management and with the Blooper Blackjack Mine, the Department of Interior, and the Forest Service Geospatial Technology and Application Center. When I'm approached by an environmental engineer or an ecologist or a botanist or a silviculturalist with an idea of how to use that drone, you know, kind of talking to them about that, and trying to meet those needs, where does the drone fit that information management gap? How can that new technology be leveraged to get information that we haven't been able to get before? And that's the direction we're going, and it's great.